Greetings and welcome to the LGR wrap-up for October 2012, where we're taking a look at crap that's happened over the past month on the channel, related to it, and gaming in general. I'm feeling a bit under the weather at the moment, so forgive any lack of enthusiasm. Not that you could probably notice that much anyway. And let's go ahead and take a look at the stuff that's happened on Lazy Game Reviews here on YouTube and such over the past month. And, first off, we are doing another wrap-up here, obviously. I wasn't sure if there'd be another one, but apparently there is, because it seems to have gone over rather well, so thank you everyone for the words of encouragement and letting me know that this isn't complete garbage. On that note, the channel itself is doing quite nicely. Yay! 50,000 plus subscribers now and almost 14 million views, which is awesome. Another thing that's pretty awesome and actually kind of disturbing is there's this new analytics feature on YouTube which will display the cumulative minutes that people have spent watching my videos. And quite creepily, it adds up to over 159 years at this point. So that's over a century and a half that people have spent watching Lazy Game Reviews. So holy crap, thanks for watching. I feel kind of guilty. I mean, I'm pretty sure there would have been some diseases cured by now if people weren't watching my videos, but hey, that's okay. Something else that's kind of cool, if you think this is cool anyway, is there is now a subreddit made for LGR. A fan of mine put it together, and at this point there's really not anything on there, but if that's your thing and you'd like to discuss whatever you want to discuss about the show, there, you can do it. And of course, if you don't want to, there's always Facebook and Twitter, which I've been using for quite a while now, and that's a little bit more established, but it's another option. Now, last thing I want to touch on really quick is LGR Plays. And the fact that some people seem to be thinking they're reviews, and as such, thinking they're of very low quality. Well, yeah, if they were reviews, or if they were even hinted at that they were reviews, then you would be right. They would suck, because they don't go into much detail. They often aren't about the entire game. It's just me playing a game for 20 to 30 minutes, usually just giving my thoughts on it before I haven't even completed it yet. It's a first impression series, essentially. Sometimes it's a little bit more than that if I've already beaten the game, but still, it's not a review. Sometimes I'm okay at the game, sometimes I play it pretty badly. That's just kind of how it goes. I don't know how it's going to go when I record it. That's, they're games. So, if you don't care to see that kind of thing, feel free to not watch them. It's really not that big of a deal. I've had a few people actually over just the past month saying they're going to unsubscribe to me if I keep making these LGR plays. Alrighty, that's fine. You go ahead and do that. Although it does seem that some people aren't aware that you can actually subscribe to different portions of my channel. If you look down below the videos in the bottom right, you'll see something that says what the thing is. A show name, like LGR Plays is a separate show. The reviews are a separate show. And then other things within those shows are divided up into playlists. Like I have a playlist just for Sims reviews, a playlist just for hardware reviews. So, if you don't want one particular kind of content, then, feel free to unsubscribe to the entire channel and then just subscribe to a part of it. You just want to see reviews? Just subscribe to the review show. You'll still get them in your subscriptions whenever I add them to the show, which is usually right after uploading. So, that should solve your problems if it's really that big of a deal. Alright, moving on to the games that I have been playing over the past month but haven't covered on the channel. And the first one is Bastion, and yes, I finally got around to playing this, and the hype was very much founded. Although I didn't find it particularly engaging past a couple or few hours. I've been told that the ending is pretty spectacular, so I'll probably try to get to that at least, but it's still a really good game, and quite unique. Another one I finally got around to playing is The Bard's Tale from 2005. This is surprisingly entertaining. I like the fact that it makes fun of pretty much everything in the action RPG genre, and it just doesn't take itself seriously at all, but it's actually quite fun and pretty solid as far as gameplay goes. Definitely one to check out, especially as it's been on sale for so cheap. Tropico 4 is another one that I finally got around to playing, and I actually haven't played a Tropico game ever before this one, and it's awesome. It really is. It kind of feels like SimCity meets Civilization meets the Caesar games meets a communist dictatorship or something. It's freaking awesome. Definitely worth checking out if you like city builders. One that probably isn't so much worth getting, at least if you have a PC, is Doom 3 BFG Edition. Though if you have a PS3, it's definitely worth getting because it comes with Doom 3, the expansion to that, a new episode, as well as Doom 1 and 2, which were previously only on the Xbox 360 as far as consoles go, so that's pretty freaking awesome. Of course, if you have a 360 and those games already, this isn't that big of a deal. Although it's nice to have Doom 3 on there, and of course it also adds the option to have flashlights mounted on your armor, which means you don't have to switch back and forth between your gun and flashlights, which really, really changes the game, actually. It doesn't seem as, like, horror-y as much anymore. You're just kind of roaming around, shooting stuff. Whatever. Some people will like it, some people won't. But yeah, the PC, freaking worthless. I mean, you have all this crap already on the PC, not to mention better versions. This one actually takes the Doom 3 code and simplifies it for consoles, so you have, like, baked-in lighting. There's no real-time lighting anymore. There's not nearly as many graphics options. You can't modify it, at least with the regular mods that you could with Doom 3. And at this point, it's completely replaced the Doom games on Steam, so you can no longer buy the Doom pack or Doom 3, the original. No, you have to get this one, the inferior one. The only decent addition is something that I can't make use of anyway, and that's the fact that it has, like, 3D in there, so if you have 3D glasses, you can do that. And it'll also work with the Oculus Rift. Maybe I'll use it at some point, but I won't be using them now, so who cares? This is stupid. One that is pretty much friggin' awesome, though, is Hawken, at least the closed beta version that I've been playing. This has been getting a lot of attention recently because it's an indie game, but it looks like AAA in quality. It's really, really fantastic. Whether or not the gameplay is something you're going to enjoy is totally going to be up to your tastes, because some people like their mech games to be slow and simulation-y and whatever, kind of like MechWarrior and Earth Siege. Well, this is not. It's kind of like a mixture of those and something like Quake 3, you know, a competitive shooter. It's pretty awesome and very fast-paced. I like it. On the flip side, I've also been playing the beta for MechWarrior Online. Now, the last MechWarrior I played was MechWarrior 2, actually. I was much more of a fan of the Earth Siege series. And, you know, this feels very reminiscent of both of those, and that's pretty much awesome. I've missed this kind of mech game. You know, it's much slower, much more methodical and strategic than something like Hawken is. It's the other end of the mech game spectrum, so this is definitely one to keep an eye on. Oh yeah, and it's worth noting that both Hawken and MechWarrior Online are going to be free-to-play games. Online only, too, so you don't get any single-player stuff, which is kind of a downer. So whether or not you like that business model will pretty much determine whether or not you think these games are worth your time. Another one I've been messing around with is Need for Speed Most Wanted, the not really a remake at all of the 2005 classic from Black Box. This one's by Criterion, and, well, I mean, it's fun, but the people that have been saying that it really is Burnout Paradise 2 were really right. It's Burnout Paradise, again. Just with car licenses and some slight influences of Most Wanted, it really doesn't feel like Most Wanted, the 2005 one. You don't have those silly characters to chase in the Most Wanted list, you just have a bunch of faceless names. There's not nearly as much customization. I mean, there's some, but there's just not much. I mean, and then there's all this stuff from friggin' Burnout Paradise. The same kind of jumps, the same smashing through billboards, the same insane physics, the same wrecking, the same takedown and crash mechanics and all that. So if you were looking for another Most Wanted, this is not it. If you were looking for another Burnout Paradise, this is not it. It's friggin' Need for Burnout Most Paradise, really, so. And lastly, we've got Assassin's Creed 3, which I actually finished playing on Halloween night, and man, this is one of the games that I have been most conflicted about all year long. Now, I'll be doing like an LGR Plays video once the PC version comes out later November, but let me just touch on some stuff here. The thing is, the game is awesome in so many ways, but at the same time, you have something that's a downside for every upside. I'm not a huge fan of the characters that you play as. There are a lot of bugs and a lot of glitches even after the day one patch. The ending of the game is complete and total garbage, especially as a longtime Assassin's Creed fan, although I don't think I would be very pleased even if I wasn't a fan of the previous games. And yeah, I could just go on and on. I mean, it's not a terrible game by any means. The new stuff that they've added, like the frontier and the ships, naval battle stuff, is freaking awesome. And I do like the American Revolution time period. But at the same time, it's kind of a disadvantage because it's not nearly as grand of a scale, and you don't really have any exotic kind of locations that you did in like Assassin's Creed 2 and Revelations and Brotherhood. Things are kind of drab in comparison. Still a solid game though, and I don't regret getting it, it's just, it could have been so much better It just feels like it fell pretty short. Alright, time for the collection update. So, yes, the things that have been added to my physical collection. First one here is Wizardry, Proving Grounds of the Mad Overlord. Man, I have been looking for a boxed copy of this forever. Thing is, they normally go for well over $100 for either the IBM PC or Apple II version. This is the IBM version, and I only got it for like $20, so balls yeah. Another one I got was Car and Driver, which I've already done a review on. And yeah, this is one that I've been looking for forever. I've never seen a copy of this show up on eBay before. It finally did. I had to pay like $35 for it, but it was worth it because this game is pretty unique and it adds to my Looking Glass Studios collection quite nicely. Next up is a game called Sidewinder, and this I had never heard of and couldn't find much information on until I saw it on eBay and like, whoa, what is this? It's like a vertical scrolling shoot 'em up. So, heck yeah, new games that are new to me, but old. Also got Magic Crayon, which you might be thinking, what the frick is wrong with you? Well, it's because it is a game by Bill Deeds. Yes, the designer of the game Animal Quest that I reviewed during Edutainment Month of this year. I've never seen a retail version of his games anywhere. And yes, this is a full retail version of Magic Crayon. And looks like they also sell Animal Quest. That gives me hope that maybe someday I'll find that retail as well. Next up here is a game apparently written by Orson Scott Card called Neo Hunter, designed by the people that did X-Wing and TIE Fighter and Super Star Wars. It's an anime-style adventure game, I think. Looks pretty sweet, maybe I'll get to review it someday. Here's another one donated to me, it was Manhunter New York. I've been on the lookout for this one for a while, so pretty awesome that it was sent to me. It's got some water damage, but whatever, discs are still working and all the contents are there, so yes, definitely one to keep in mind for a review someday. And lastly, we've got another donation here, Three Dirty Dwarves, which apparently is some kind of 2D beat-em-up thing. And it looks pretty awesome, so thank you for the donations, everyone. Please keep them coming because, more stuff to review is good stuff to review, or something. Alright, final segment here. We got some gaming news to cover. First up is Cliffy B. Yes, Cliff Bleszinski left Epic Games near the beginning of the month, and wow, that's pretty crazy. Honestly, I wasn't expecting that at all. I mean, the guy has been one of my idols since I was a kid. I friggin' loved Jazz Jackrabbit and even Castle of the Winds, Dare to Dream, and of course Unreal and pretty much everything that he's ever done. So I was kind of shocked, honestly, but it's cool at the same time because, hey, maybe he'll go on and do some new things, do creative crap, whatever he wants to do. Good luck to him. I will definitely be following what he's doing, and, you know, hopefully he doesn't totally drop off the radar like Will Wright did. I mean, I know he's doing, like, robots and stuff, but maybe Cliff will do robots with chainsaws and green rabbits. I would go for that. So, yeah, Cliff, feel free to take my ideas. Next up is some Windows 8 stuff. It's not only been released, but it was announced at one point during the month that the marketplace would not carry PEGI 18 plus games. And that was kind of a problem because, well, 18 plus games, that's a lot of stuff. Not just like so-called adult content or the AO rated stuff here. Now that would be like rated M stuff here. Whatever, they reversed that, so this is no longer a news story. But what is news is, well, Windows 8 itself. A lot of people have been asking me about it, like, are you going to get it? Are you going to do any videos on it? No and no. I have zero interest in Windows 8. I do not plan on using it on any of my desktops, except for just pure morbid curiosity. I will use it whenever I get like a Microsoft Surface or something because it is an OS made for touch screen computers. For a desktop, it makes no sense to me. I have Windows 7 Ultimate 64-bit and it works just fine for everything out there. Until that changes, I won't be using Windows 8 on my desktop. Something that's quite interesting in the retro gaming and collector's world, especially for you 2600 people, is Air Raid. Yes, Air Raid has surfaced again, twice in 1 month, both of them boxed copies. One that's on Game Gavel, it's actually still going, it's up to almost $16,000 at the moment, actually comes with the instruction manual. And in case you're not aware, this is like one of the rarest and just strangest, most unknown information kind of games out there. Estimated that like less than 20 copies exist. Many of them just plain carts. One was in a box in 2010, and this one has both the box and the instructions. Then there was also one on eBay that ended on the 29th for almost $14,000, although it was in the box, it didn't have the instruction manual. The one in 2010 that was believed to be the only one in the box at the time actually sold for almost $32,000, so yeah, this one on GameGabble could go for a lot. Also, news from the end of the month is that Disney has bought Lucasfilm and everything they have. So yeah, that's Skywalker Sound, that's Lucasfilm, the movies, properties, I mean, that's Star Wars. It's freaking everything, including LucasArts. Yes, they got it all for $4.05 billion. Quite interesting, though, that George Lucas is no longer going to be involved except as like a creative consultant, which means that the new Star Wars movies, yes, there is a new Star Wars movie planned already by Disney, Star Wars 7, coming in 2015, is not going to have Lucas directing or producing or whatever. He's just there to be like, oh, I'm doing George Lucas things. That's what he's going to do. Honestly, what I'm more wondering about is what exactly is going to happen to the LucasArts games arm of the company because, well, Disney revealed that once all the acquisition stuff is complete, they're going to shift everything at LucasArts to focus on mobile and social gaming rather than console or PC action games. Now, what this means for the stuff that's already in the works, like the next-gen games, like Star Wars 1313 and whatever else, or maybe a future Battlefront, or who the frick knows? I mean, what does it mean for LucasArts games if they're going to be focusing on social and crap? I don't know. It sounds kind of dismal to me. Or who knows? Maybe we'll be getting, like, mobile versions of the classic Star Wars games. I could go for that. Maybe we'll see Pixar's Grim Fandango, or Star Wars toys showing up in Toy Story. I don't know. I mean, I could see some different things happening that could be kind of cool, but yeah, it's like when Disney bought Marvel. Nobody really knew what was going on, what could happen to their more mature properties, or what would happen to them at all. They would just be absorbed. I don't know. We'll see. Similar to the Dark Engine patch from last month, this month we have something else that I wasn't expecting to see at all, like ever, and that is Super Mario 64 multiplayer. Yes, indeed. You can now play Super Mario 64 with a modified ROM or Wii Channel WAD or whatever with friends, either locally with multiple controllers or actually online using Kalera. And this is just freaking cool. I mean, I can't say I've ever really thought about playing Mario 64 with other people. Maybe it crossed my mind at some point, but hey, whatever. This guy did. It's awesome. I'll check out the mod if I were you, because if anything, it's just weird. And quite the technical achievement. The link for it is in the video description below. And one last thing I want to touch on is SimCity. Coming in 2013, yes, SimCity 5, as it's also known, has been getting a lot of attention over the month of October with all these gameplay streams and videos and whatnot. As such, a lot of people have been asking my opinions on it, and well, I don't have a whole lot at the moment, just a lot of concerns, because really, I haven't played the game, and I don't really know what to think from the gameplay videos because they don't really go into a whole lot of depth, so I'm not going to make a final call on it whatsoever. I do, however, have some pretty major concerns, and well, I don't think it should be any surprise that the DRM is a big one. Whether or not they want to call it DRM, it's DRM. If you have people being locked out of the game because they're not online, that's DRM. So yes, you do at least have to activate the game when you start it up, which at this point it sounds like it is every time that you start the game. That's a pain. I've also heard about the always-on potential DRM stuff because you can't actually save your game offline. Like, it doesn't save to your hard drive, it saves to the cloud. So you have to be online in order to save your game. You can play it offline, you just can't save your game. So that may as well be always on as far as I'm concerned. Other things that concern me are the city sizes. Apparently it's only 2 kilometer square for each city. And that's as big as the medium cities were in SimCity 4. So that is, that seems pretty small because I liked the really, really large maps in SimCity 4. Those are the ones I played. I didn't ever play the smaller ones unless I was just making cities to, like, dump garbage in. And that kind of seems like what the focus is for this one. You have regions and then individual cities to just make, like, one city's just industry, one city's just residential, one city's a garbage dump. One city is an airport, you know, an international airport. And I don't really like playing like that. I'd like playing larger cities. Maybe they'll integrate it in such a way that it works. I don't know. I haven't seen the specifics of that. Another thing that's somewhat concerning is there's no terraforming. Apparently, they just don't have it in there at all because of the way that the systems work, like the water tables and things like that. Apparently, don't really allow for terraforming, so you just kind of build around mountainscapes and such. That is a disappointment. Terraforming is a big part of the game. It has been since SimCity 2000. Even SimCity Classic had the terrain editor, so not being able to edit your terrain like that is, There's also what seems to be kind of a lack of mass transportation. Like, there's no subways at all. The road connections to other cities are pretty limited. They can only be placed in predetermined areas of the map. Then, of course, there's the airport thing. Like, you can't have an international airport in your city because it takes up the entire map, 2 by 2 kilometers. You can have, like, a regional airport, and that's cool. But really, all of this stuff, it makes it seem like it should be SimTown Online. Just call it SimTown Online. I would be happy with that. Because you call it SimCity, and as a longtime SimCity player, you expect a lot of things. This doesn't seem to be really fulfilling any of those. It's doing a lot of other really cool stuff, though. I mean, I'm really looking forward to seeing all this glass box real-time kind of stuff coming into action because it looks awesome. Like, all the little minutiae that you can keep up with is cool, but it's on a much, much smaller scale. And that concerns me, just because it does. I have no reason to think it'll be awful, but it is a major concern. So yeah, we will see whenever the beta comes online. I'm hoping to get a hold of that and maybe have a more complete opinion on it then. And of course, just wait for the game coming in March of 2013. So yes, that is that. And that's all for the LGR wrap-up of October 2012. And thanks for watching. And thanks for allowing the video to stop here in a couple seconds. Although you really don't have a choice because the video is going to stop whether or not you want it to stop or not, because it's the end of the video. That is the most amazing thing about obviousness.